Okay, welcome back. Today is Wednesday, September 29, almost the end of September. This month has gone real fast. This is episode 29 of the reading through of Chuang Tzu, 29 hours, called this local train. Meaning little by little, step by step. I think that's quite safe in terms of spiritual path and transformation, and also seeking a really deep understanding. This is quality over quantity, although there's a certain quantity of talks. The detail is where we can make some breakthrough, meaning looking deeper into what we already know, what we think we know, we only know to a certain depth. And knowing goes ever deeper. There's no limit, in a way, to wisdom, because there's no limit to creation, or there's no limit to comprehension, even in the finite realm or relative truth. there's so much more deeper. We can understand anything, everything. And knowing that is sort of a guarantee that we can deepen, continue ever deepening understanding. And so that's why I take this, like, take reading the raw material word by word or line by line, session by session, and going into it exhaustively. To deepen understanding is really valuable. So we're on page 125 of the Burton Watson translation of Chuang Tzu. And at the end of this chapter 6, The Great and Venerable Teacher, which I think is maybe the most important chapter of the book, certainly it's got some of the best teaching, and we've gone through most of that already, actually. And so the last half of the chapter, the next 10 pages to finish the chapter, is a series of stories. And these stories illustrate certain Taoist teachings, principles of the Zhenren, and how the sage Zhenren accords with heaven and man, how they make their accord rightly with polarity. the principle of Wu Wei actually is critical in being able to, as we said last time, see that life and death are on a single string, or it was acceptable and unacceptable are on a single string, and how life and death are the same story. So polarity of what we want and what we don't want, what's pleasant and what's painful, is of a single life, is life in the sense of existence. And the 10,000 changes, or the 10,000 things, are in an endless change. In some way, the Chinese Taoist perspective, Chuang Tzu's Chinese Taoist perspective, is similar to Greek and Roman Stoicism. Some portion of the teaching, the moral philosophy, in terms of how to live in this situation where we have fate and we have some kind of destiny, fate and destiny. Then we have the world of men and a path of development. this, some portion of the guidance is kind of stoic, like Marcus Aurelius. As a Roman philosopher, Stoic, making clear his teaching includes this view of making real clear what's under our control, what's not, what we can change, what we can't. Like this, I think a serenity prayer. I don't know if that's Ronald Niebuhr or some other Christian or Catholic theologian or philosopher saying, you know, God, give me the strength to change what I can, and the what the acceptance to accept what I cannot change, and the wisdom to know the difference. And that's very much about green, blue, indigo. And so the acceptance to change what we can't is very much about love, or heart chakra, green ray. And the strength to change what we can is very much associated with the strength of self, the sense of self. And that's the 2-4-6 line, or the 2-6 chakra band. Second chakra, sense of self, in the common way. Sixth chakra, higher self, true nature. To what extent is 6-2 in communication? To what extent have we spiritualized the sense of self? And the Junren, has that work done well? Has done well the work of spiritualizing sense of self? And that gives the courage or the strength to change what we can. There's also the strength to accept what we cannot. And so the basis of love, even the love that's unconditional acceptance, is strength or courage. That strength or courage very much depends on character. Character very much depends on the sense of self, the sense of what I is, the personal, the way we define our personal. And that very much is going to be limited or expansive, expanded where the sense of self has been spiritualized realistically with wisdom, or the sense of self is very limited to feeling bad about ourselves or seeing only weaknesses and faults and distortion. So the strength to make the change, to change what I can, the acceptance to change what I, to accept what I cannot, the heart, the love, really, the patience to accept what I cannot change, and that patience to be able to accept what we can't change very much, again, depends on character or the sense of self. And that's particularly the spiritualization. To what extent I know that I'm more than my body, and I'm also aware of my capacities and resilience to get through or accept what I don't want. Like in the book 2150, this phrase, the measure of a mind's evolution is the ability to accept the unacceptable. And so the development of character and the development of soul and expansion of awareness and development of seven rays overall, feeding into the sense of self as a basis for the strength or self-confidence or trust and faith, perhaps, even trusting without fully knowing that I somehow will get through it or I can accept it. And then the discernment to know the difference, being fifth ray, very much so. And that also has much to do with the sense of self. Meaning, if we have a lot of blind spots, it's because we don't want to see what we feel is too painful to see. And being able to sit with the pain of seeing what we feel is unpleasant or painful to see, certain truths that are bitter, we feel are bitter. That wisdom of seeing, which requires acceptance to acknowledge, yes, it's true, I don't like it, it's true, very much of wisdom, but that wisdom, fifth ray, is very much related to second ray, so that's the 2-5 chakra connection. In any case, that is some metaphysics associated with both Greek and Roman Stoicism and Chuang-Tzu's Chinese Taoism. And that's very important and interesting. So let's jump in, page 125. The first of these stories, I'm not going to read every one of them fully, but I'm going to read them over. And you'll see, because this is really original Chuang-Tzu. This is not coming from later compilers and editors putting in other perspectives. I think these stories, in my view, are of the oldest stratum of this text. So, page 125, and I'll read the whole story through and then comment a bit and go to the next. And we've got a dialogue between a seeker and a female sage. And so the seeker's name is Nanpo Zikui, and the woman who's a sage, his name is Woman Crookback. And so you'll see in these stories a lot of physical deformity as catalyst or featuring in the stories. And the way the sage or Dunren is facing the physical deformity or death as a demonstration of their attainment or their realization of Tao, as well as, you know, their spiritual maturity, offering Taoist philosophy. So Nan Po Zhi Kui said to the woman crook back, "You are old in years, and yet your complexion is that of a child. Why is this?" And she replies, "I have heard the Tao." "Can the Tao be learned?" asked Nan Po Zhi Kui to her. And she replies at length, "Goodness, how could that be?" Meaning, how could you learn the Tao? "Anyway, you are not the man to do it." And she goes to some, talks to someone else, and or refers to. Now there's Bu Liang Yi. He has the talent of a sage, but not the way or Tao of a sage. So there's the difference between the talent of a sage and the Tao of a sage. Talent is their ability, and way is, I would say, their attainment and transformed consciousness, awareness. So he has the talent of a sage, but not the way or the Tao of a sage, whereas I have the Tao of a sage, but not the talent of a sage. Meaning I can't teach her and help as well as he with talent, but I know. And she goes on, "I thought I would try to teach him." And so she's talking about this other guy. "I thought I would try to teach him and see if I could really get anywhere near to making him a sage." Of course, it's really making him, helping him make himself a sage. She goes on, "It's easier to explain the Tao of a sage to someone who has the talent of a sage, you know." And so somebody with the talent or abilities may understand the meaning more readily. "So I began explaining and kept at him for 3 days." And here we have the sequence of attainment. "So I began explaining to him and kept at him for 3 days. And after that, he was able to put the world outside himself. When he had put the world," so that's one, "put the world outside himself, after that, I kept at him for 7 more days. And after that, he was able to put things outside himself." That's two. "Then, when he had put things outside himself, I kept at him for 9 more days. After that, he was able to put life outside himself." Stage three. "After he had put life outside himself, he was able to achieve the brightness of dawn," 4, "and when he had achieved the brightness of dawn, he could see his own aloneness," 5. "After he had managed to see his own aloneness, then he could do away with past and present," and after he had done, that's 6, "and after he had done away with past and present, he was able to enter where there is no life and no death," 7. "That which kills life does not die. That which gives life does not live. This is the kind of thing it is, which is Tao. There's nothing it doesn't send off, nothing it doesn't welcome, nothing it doesn't destroy, nothing it doesn't complete. Its name is peace in strife. After the strife, it attains completion." And so, after that, there's a little cute paragraph about where'd you learn that from, and I think that's not, it's a little bit more confusing than it's worth. But this sequence of 7 stages of attainment to the way of a sage, as she's explaining with her own relative talent of a sage, is very interesting. And so, number one is putting the world outside. Number one is able to put the world outside himself. Then put things outside himself, then put life outside himself. So the world, and then things, and then himself. The world might mean concern with the world, my engagement in my mind with the world, or my attachments with the so-called outer, or the social, or the interpersonal. To be able to rightly forget the world. Then put things outside himself. What things? Well, it's probably thought, the mental reflection of the world. And so there's concern with the world as we move out of the sense of being over, there's engagement and attachments with the world or the so-called outer. And then there's the reflection of all that engagement and attachment preference inwardly in terms of mind, in the process or field of mind. In the process of mind, in the field of mind, we have our own world. The world is in my mind, as well as outside my body. And so being able to forget temporarily or long-term, I mean rightly, you know, there's wise forgetting and harmful forgetting. Wisely forget, forget or put outside, there's wise and unwise forgetting. But this point of putting the world outside himself may well mean breaking unnecessary engagements or entanglement with the outside, so-called. Then putting things outside himself, I think, is the inward reflection and concerns with that. Put life outside himself, I don't know for sure, but it could be the force, the momentum of our over-concern or our concern inwardly in mind, the force of the mental reflection of the outer world and our attachments and our relationships. So first we make some worldly detachment, then we make some detachment or forgetting, setting aside of the inner mind process, being able to move to quiet in mind. That going to quiet in mind also requires putting life outside myself, really experiencing your own death, in a sense, or at least a deep, quiet mind, a deep, quiet mind that can be finished with feeling the feelings we've been suppressing. So that's why meditation is hard. One reason is that we can't put things outside ourselves, or we can't put the mind process aside. We can't forget. We can't become quiet. We can't become concentrated or centered, because we're too much in the monkey mind, or too much in the continual mental flow, very much associated with our thoughts about the world and relationship and the future and the past. To be able to really settle that down to a quieter mind is also associated with putting this life outside himself and slowing down, cooling down the force and the momentum we realize is not I either. The I is observing it all and making right detachment from wrong relationship or right detachment from wrong engagement with the world and the outer is one. Making right detachment and right forgetting, wise forgetting, not stupid forgetting, not harmful, forgetting and setting aside or putting away the mental process too, the excessive or unnecessary mental process, generally that will require catharsis, meaning feeling the painful feelings that we've been avoiding before the mind can get quiet. And the quieting then involves that putting life outside himself too. Putting life outside himself, I think, refers to the life behind the continuance of attachment to things or mental process. Both. So putting the life outside himself really, I think, is a radical cooling down. And that doesn't happen when we're carrying a lot of fear and grief and anger. So the grief and the fear and the anger has to be vented or rightly released or catharsis to be able to really slow down, cool down, become still, increasingly still. Then, when those three detachments have been made, he's able to achieve the brightness of dawn. And that is a certain kind of, I would say, a recognition of the intrinsic brightness of self or mind free of activity. The stilled mind is not a dull, dead mind. It's not tree stump samadhi, as some Buddhists would say. Tree stump samadhi as a kind of, you know, you get whacked in the head by a bat, and if you're still conscious, you can't, you're dazed and confused or dazed and thoughtless, like shell shock. Shell shock is a quiet mind too, right? But there's huge distress and foggy, and it's not very bright. It's kind of dark, and it's kind of painful. This is a quiet mind that's not dark, not painful, But alert, alert, you know, attentive, like mindfulness, like a goals in mindfulness, sati. So achieve the brightness of dawn, and that's actually, there's even a dialogue. One Thai forest tradition teacher, I forgot who it was, it might have even been, I don't know if it's actually a John Lee Damodaro, but it's somebody talking to the high advanced student who attains some brightness after they go through a quiet mind, after they can dwell attentively in quiet mind with some body-mind stillness. There's a recognition of light, the intrinsic light of mind or awareness that comes through, that is the basis of mind. You know, the brightness of the spirit that is what allows mind, right? It's body to mind to spirit. And each one is a successively, can be considered to some degree a source of the lower. So mind as a source of body, spirit as a source of body-mind. Spirit as source of body-mind. Higher self as the source of body-mind-spirit. And the logos as the source of the higher self, which itself is a source of mind-body-spirit. So the three of mind-body-spirit sourced in the one of higher self, or the unity, unified awareness of higher self. That one awareness of unity of higher self sourced in or came from the indefinability of logos, or logos as source, or God as source, the source of, so that logos, you know, higher self as a sub logos, Ra said, solar logos as the next step up. So achieve the brightness of dawn is a certain quiet, stilled mind, spiritualized mind, clarity, awareness of the brightness of true nature. When he achieved brightness of dawn, he could see his own aloneness. And that, I think, is very similar to Nityananda saying that the yani, or in great realization, one no longer experiences I'm in the world, but the world's in me. Meaning, I'm not a little billiard ball on the table, but the table was made by this mind. Or this consciousness and awareness, it's not even my conscious self. It's not that the conscious mind makes reality. It's awareness makes the conscious mind that's aware of reality or phenomena. But it's self-born. Just like the creation is self-born of the logos, experience is self-born of consciousness. So he could see his own aloneness, all is one. His aloneness is also seeing unity. And so things and, or the world and the things and the life, its momentum and brightness is all one, and this is only I. It doesn't mean I'm better. It's everybody has, for all beings, it's like this. So see his own aloneness, which is also could be solitary unity or awareness of non-duality. He then could do away with past and present. Now we're getting to higher self and beyond. He could do away with past and present. And after he'd done away with past and present, he was able to enter where there is no life and no death. Where there is no life and no death is the source of life and death. The source of phenomena that arise, persist, passed away. Life and death is that which arises, persists, and passes away. Samsara, right? Birth, the realm of birth and death, which is the 31 planes, seven dimensions. Phenomenal appearance and decay. Doing away with that is returning to the source before there was time and space and phenomena. So now it's going from sixth density to eight. Enter where there is no life and no death. Leap into the boundless, make it your home. That which kills life doesn't die. So the basis of life ending or being killed is deathless. That which gives life doesn't live. The basis of creation is uncreated. So creation comes from the uncreated, and death comes from the deathless. So the uncreated and deathless are the same, of course. So the uncreated, deathless source that's before time and space, before light, basically. Light is the substance of the octaves. Light is the substance of the octaves. It's prior to the seven rays, but subsequent to that which is preluminal. So there's the action of free will upon love, Ra said. The action of infinite will on infinite love, giving rise to light. That action is preluminal, before light. Preluminal is the deathless, meaning it wasn't born. It's not a thing that arose, persists, pass away. It's before things. The things are things of light. Mind is of light. Mind is made of light. Body, mind, spirit complex, the seven-dimensional sense of self, the seven-dimensional vehicle, or the seven-dimensional self is really is awareness that has identified with vehicles. The vehicles are seven-dimensional energy fields called seven chakras and center seven energy bodies. That is, as Ra said, mind, body, spirit, beingness, totality, complex. Mind, body, spirit, beingness, totality, complex is the complex of seven-dimensional energy fields, each of a different level of consciousness, awareness, expansion, of increasingly greater awareness and increasingly less or decreasingly less attachment and identification with the vehicle, right? You can't know yourself as a mind and a being if you're an animal. Animals don't know that they're knowing. They have consciousness, but they don't have self-consciousness. So the human with self-consciousness has some sense of, I am a me. I'm a me. The animal doesn't think, I'm a me. The animal may think, but doesn't know it's thinking. So we have this experience where we know we're thinking, or we think we're thinking, we believe we're thinking, so then we believe I'm a me. Why? Because I'm identifying. There's this awareness is identifying with the body-mind. Then, when somebody opens their heart, we have some sense of spirit, or some sense of, I'm not only this body and mind, I am the one that has a body-mind, or I am consciousness. Well, that's not the end of the line either. So then that's awareness of my body spirit. I am a temporarily human being. I am a spirit having a human experience, they can say. But actually it's more than that, or we are. We is more than that. I is more than that. And so infinite awareness generates light. Or infinite awareness, the power, infinite power, infinite love of infinity, intelligent infinity, one infinite creator, source, wishes there to be light, generates light. That light takes shape as seven dimensions, seven rays, basically. It takes shape as seven vibratory patterns, seven rays, seven dimensions. Then we have an octave. And then there's a descent of awareness into that vehicle of light, which is called higher self. Sub-logos. And that sub-sub-logos identifies with the vehicles of light. And that leads to the emanation called mind-body-spirit complex, which then, on the evolutionary path, successively detaches from misidentification with lower vehicles like body and then mind and then spirit. So seeing his aloneness is not even the end of the line. Then he enters where there's no life and no death. That's before the birth of aloneness. See his own aloneness is seeing something that's been born. So like Nisargadatta saying that the Yani, then after self-realization, seeing his own aloneness is like self-realization, very much like higher self. Doing away with that is to go beyond, to go to the source of the perception, the source of what I is that has the perception of aloneness. Perception of we become light. Ra said we become light, right? We no longer seek light, we become light. No, you now believe you become light. You believe you are a light. That's an identity. We become light. We're light. Oh, okay. Well, that's going to be dropped, leaving sixth density, go to seven, dropping memory identity, is going beyond perception of aloneness or experience of all is one. And that's doing away with past and present because there's no more experience of an aloneness that can know a past and a present, then one goes beyond that and sees there's no life and death. So no past and present, the aloneness perceives a past and present. Aloneness perceiving a past and present finally goes beyond the experience of aloneness or all is one, I is the one light, and in this one light we have some sense of past present, or there's no past and present with the one light, but there's still life and death. There's the life and death of the perception of no past present. The perception of aloneness, the perception of past and present, the perception that past and present is one, includes a perception of past and present, right? To say that many is one is based on a perception of many. So that's why experience of unity is not true non-duality. If you follow, if you're still with me on the local train, which seems to be going a little faster around the curves, so don't think the local train doesn't go hyper sometimes. The local train, sometimes we go leisurely and sometimes we go hyperspace, hyperspeed. So this aloneness, I is one light, may still be perceiving past, present, future. Then there's a sense of I'm beyond... all this past, present, future is now, but there's still a perception of past, present, future that's being now, or all one, or all now. All now is a perception based on a past, present perception of past, present, future, or past and present that is now. Okay, so awareness of unity includes the recognition that there's a many, the belief in the substantial many that really is one. So we become light is based on a perception that light is substantial or light is real. Rather than knowing it as a dream made by a source before light. So after the does away, after aloneness, while still perceiving past present, he can do away with past present, where it's all now, or past, present, future. But he's doing away with that, and so there's no more time. But there's a sense that there was a thing called time. And then the life and the death, or the arising even of perception, for ends. And Gautama said it. Gautama said, in complete and perfect enlightenment, there's cessation of perception and consciousness. So there's no longer a subjective consciousness that is experiencing perception of past, present, future, even being all one. So perceiving insubstantiality is still a perceiving. Perceiving all is light, or all is light and I is this light, is still a perception. Right? That's why the higher formless jhanas are still perceptual. Perception of infinity, perception of infinite space, infinite consciousness, perception of nothingness, perception, or then neither perception nor non-perception. Eighth jhana, which is like seventh density, is like is nearly logoic before source, or at the point of source. It's right a moment, just an inch away from source, this eighth jhana. So he's able to enter where there's no life and no death. So he's aware of the boundless prior to light that has life and death, or so-called life and death, that arises and passes away. So beyond the realm of birth and death. Hey, beyond samsara, beyond seven densities, beyond 31 planes, triloka. That which kills life doesn't die. So the source of life that dies is not dying. The source that makes what we call life and activity doesn't live. It's infinite power in infinite love generating light that lives and dies. And that infinity of power, love, or intelligent infinity, can't be said to live or die. And it doesn't arise. Your dancing thoughts, the illusion of light, Ra said, the concept of light, the illusion of light, it's illusion. It's in the mind of infinity somehow, or it's made by infinity. and its true nature is infinity. This is the kind of thing it is, meaning the Tao. Nothing it doesn't send off, meaning it sends off everything. It welcomes everything. Nothing it doesn't, right? So dual negative. Negative, negative is positive. So nothing it doesn't send off, welcome, destroy, complete. So nothing it doesn't means no negative, negative, meaning a positive. It, the Tao, the uncreated, the deathless, the prior to light, sends off everything, welcomes everything, destroys everything, completes everything. Uh-huh. So everything is initiated, send off, welcome, meaning allowed, meaning phenomenally appearing, destroy, meaning after persistence it decays and falls away, and is complete thereby. The source of life is not living. The source of death is not dying. The source of light is not light. The source of I, the true nature of the speaker for all of us, is not alive nor dead. It's not of light. It's prior to light. It's prior to the whole sequence of time and space and light and phenomenal appearance, arising, persisting, passing away, right? Brahma, Vishnu, Shiva. Before all that, before the Trinity, before the unity of the Trinity, old Arios gets plotted. Before the Trinity is the unity that appears as a Trinity. Oh my God, another snake? This is the eighth now. This must be a friend of Nityananda or something. They love me. They just love this house. And this is a growing snake. Ay, ay, ay. Hold on. Pause. All right. Carrying on indefatigably. We had a snake nursery of eight or seven snakes, and it looks like one of them has returned because he or she likes me. So, yeah. The perils of being a Nagamitra. Nagamitra means friend of the snakes. Anyway, I have not yet put life outside myself, so... But I'll try to see my own aloneness and see there is no snake, or I am the one, the snake and I are one. All right, it's a little snake, and he's not poisonous, he's just curious. But it's a little unsettling to have a snake in one's room. We'll deal with that later. So there's nothing it doesn't... this is the kind of thing it is, the Tao. Everything, it's the one that creates and sends off. It's the one that welcomes all or allows all to be, like the snake. It's the one that destroys all, meaning all that arises passing away, and all is completed too. Its name is peace in strife. After strife, it attains completion. So the strife is in my mind. Not liking a snake in my in the house, but after the strife, hopefully we both get some completion. And peace in strife is creation. And that's just like Heraclitus saying that conflict's the mother of all, and fire is the root of all, and constant change, and that is peace. If you can be like that, this is the testing, you know. I mean, this snake's not like lunging at me or anything, but it's a little unsettling. I was born in New York City where we have human snakes, but probably human snakes are more dangerous. So I'll think about that. Peace in strife, ceaseless, phenomenal appearance, decay, persistence, decay, passing away. Forever and ever, as long as we're in the octave, that's what we're getting. Light manifestations, appearing, persisting, decaying, passing away. Birth, old age, sickness, and death. Endlessly. Meanwhile, you can say that samsara is nirvana. Okay, well, I'm not there yet. And after the perception that that it is strife, after the perception, right? This is all based on perception and subjective consciousness. So after the ending of perception, after we leave sixth density and go to eight, there's completion. After perception, which leads to the perception of strife, meaning endless change, endless dukkha sukha, dukkha sukha sukha, sukha dukkha, dukkha sukha, or dukkha dukkha. There's no sukha sukha. The only sukha sukha with no dukkha is on the other side of the octave. Meanwhile, one would see the all light as, you know, God's joy when you're back to source. But I'm not there yet. So we have work to do. So its name, that which sends off everything, welcomes everything, destroys everything, and thus completes everything, the name of it that does that is peace in strife, or strife in peace. Apparent strife, endless change, dukkha sukha alternation, peace in strife. So in the strife is peace, or the strife, the true nature of the conflict, the fire burning. Like Gautama said, the true nature, its true nature is peace. Then after the strife, it attains completion. The next story starts on page 127. Master Si, Master Yu, Master Li, Master Lai, were all four talking together. He said, or one of them said, who can look on non-being as his head, on life as his back, and on death as his rump? Ass, I think. They said, this is just casual communication, casual conversation that these guys have. Who knows that life and death, existence and annihilation are all a single body? I will be his friend. The four men looked at each other and smiled. There was no disagreement in their hearts, and so the four of them became friends. All at once, Master Yu fell ill. Yep. Master Si went to ask how he was. Master Yu said, amazing. The Creator is making me all crookedy like this. Or I can say the Creator is sending a snake into my room. My back sticks up like a hunchback, and my vital organs are on top of me. My chin is hidden in my navel, my shoulders are up above my head, and my pigtail points to the sky. It must be some dislocation of the yin and yang. Yet he seemed calm at heart and unconcerned. Good model for me with the snake in the room. Dragging himself haltingly to the well, he looked at his reflection and said, my, my. So the Creator is making me all crookedy like this. Do you resent it? Asked Master Si. He replied, why, no, why would I resent it? If the process continues, perhaps in time he'll transform my left arm into a rooster. In that case, I'll keep watch during the night. Or perhaps in time he'll transform my right arm into a crossbow pellet, and I'll shoot down an owl for roasting. Or perhaps in time he'll transform my buttocks into cartwheels. Then, with my spirit for a horse, I'll climb up and go for a ride. What need will I ever have for a carriage again? And he explains his perspective, so calm and peaceful, now, top of 128, saying, I received life because the time had come. I will lose it because the order of things passes on. Be content with this time and dwell in this order, and then neither sorrow nor joy can touch you. In ancient times, this was called the, quote, freeing of the bound. There are those who cannot free themselves because they are bound by things. But nothing can ever win against heaven. That's the way it's always been. What would I have to resent? And so, time comes. The time comes for this, the time comes for that. Time comes for the snake to come back and say hello. And that's that. The order of things then passes on. So, gain is because the time has come for gain. Loss is because the order of things passes on. I mean, there's going to always be loss to gain. Always be loss to gain. Because nothing stays the same. Nothing, motionlessness is not of light. Light is vibratory polarized. Is polarized, vibratory, always, ever in motion. And so there's the order of things coming and the order of things passing on. Dwell in this order, the order of peace and strife, the order that strife can be known as peace as well, that the constancy of strife is a peace. And, you know, you can pretend you're not unwell and, you know, adopt this intellectually. That's not a good idea. To really know this as they know, presumably, is a great attainment, which requires going through emotional catharsis and being real honest about the pain we feel with the inevitable strife and loss and coming and going of phenomena. In ancient times, called freeing of the bound, and so don't presume that because you can think it, you are it. Just because you can think freedom doesn't mean you've made radical freedom. Radical freedom is a big piece of work. There are those who can't free themselves because they're bound by things or bound by attachment to things. What do we have now? Now we have Gecko, 4 feet above Snake, probably wondering what's going on. Bound by things is bound by attachment to gain and pleasure and honor and praise. You know, attachment to the 4 pleasurable worldly winds, hating the 4 unpleasant worldly winds, loving the happy, hating the sad, loving the well, hating the unwell. That is not the way of finding peace and strife. That's the way of staying in strife. Because all things change. And that's very Stoic. That's very much what Marcus Aurelius... I mean, I wouldn't be a bit surprised if the Greek philosophers... I mean, the timing, I don't know. Did Greek... The porch of Zeno's teaching, the Stoa, was it concomitant temporally, same time, same century as Zhuangzi? I don't know. I forgot the dates of these things, but it's just interesting how Greek and then later Roman Stoic philosophy arose pretty much around the same time when Taoism started and proliferated in China. And Zhuangzi, very much understanding that nothing ever stays the same, there's continual strife, yet with detachment one can find peace therein in a real way. I mean, like these guys, their bodies becoming all distorted and hunchback and very pained, or they lose their nose, or they lose their toes, or some, you know, no toes and no nose, and but they're okay. Or not only okay, they're beloved and sought out by all. That kind of thing. That's what these stories are about. People who've suffered greatly physically, or lost muchly physically, and gone beyond their suffering. They may have suffered initially, and then they came to some enlightenment and found peace in strife, or realized that acceptable, unacceptable are on a single string. Life and death, the same story. And the way of knowing that is Wu Wei. The path, one element of the path, or the mind that knows that, is associated with the principle Wu Wei. No action, which is really no interference, no interruption, not putting a head on top of your head, not... no longer involved in the unnecessary, and seeing rightly how there's continual arising, persisting, passing away, and most of this is out of our control. The time comes, the time goes. It comes, the time I receive life because the time had come. I lose it because the order of things passes on. Be content with this time and dwell in this order. Be content is also a way, in a sort of middle path between grasping and aversion. Rather than seeking to hold and keep and never lose, rather than seeking to prevent and eliminate what is unpleasant and never have it, which of course is reasonable, content with the time and dwell in the order that makes things come and go, then neither sorrow nor joy can touch you, meaning heavy despair and heavy elation, mirth. I have it. Well, things change. I lost it. Well, things will change from that too. So then the story goes on. Suddenly another guy gets sick. Suddenly Master Lai grew ill. Gasping and wheezing, he lay at the point of death. His wife and children gathered round in a circle and began to cry. Master Li, another of the friend, who'd come to ask how he was said to them, "Shoo, get back, don't disturb the process of change." Which sounds very insensitive to the family crying. And I wouldn't recommend that. Then he leaned against the doorway and talked to Master Lai. "How marvelous the Creator is," he said. "What's he going to make out of you next? Where is he going to send you? Will he make you into a rat's liver? Will he make you into a bug's arm?" Mm-hmm. Master Lai, who's dying, said, "A child, obeying his father and mother, goes wherever he is told, east or west, south or north, and the yin and yang. How much more are they to a man than a father or mother?" Meaning he must obey. It's by duty to obey father and mother, even more so than father and mother is the powers of yin-yang, which gave rise to a father and mother, a soul in a certain body with another soul in another body becoming father and mother. Greater than the father and mother power is the yin-yang power. The yin-yang, how much more are they to a man? How much more important are they to a man? They central to experience than father and mother. "Now that they have brought me to the verge of death, if I should refuse to obey them, how perverse I would be. What fault is it of theirs?" Of the yin and yang ever-changing. "The great clod," this is a term for source, only Chinese Taoists would think of it that way. "The great clod burdens me with form, labors me with life, eases me in old age, rests me in death. So if I think well of my life, for the same reason I must think well of my death. When a skilled smith is casting metal, if the metal should leap up and say, 'I insist on being made into a moi,'" it's a certain, I think, sword portion, "he would surely regard it," the smith, not Agent Smith, the smith maker, "would surely regard it as a very inauspicious metal indeed. Now, having had the audacity to take human form once, if I should say, 'I don't want to be anything but a man, nothing but a man,' the Creator would surely regard me as a most inauspicious sort of person. So now I think of heaven and earth as a great furnace, and the Creator as a skilled smith. Where could he send me that would not be all right? I will go off to sleep peacefully, and then with a start I will wake up." So these guys completely at peace with birth and death and death, when everybody's fine with our birth or we're here. He's not only okay with life, he's okay with death. So he's okay living in the world of men, but knowing that acceptable and unacceptable are on a single string, or seeing peace and strife and understanding Wu Wei or living it. I mean, understanding that life and death are the same story, acceptable, unacceptable on a single string, and that there's peace in this strife. That comes from a deep integration of the way of Wu Wei, this path of, or the habits of non-interference. And so he, 2,300 years ago, is deeply at peace with the inevitability of death and the fact he doesn't know where he's going. "Then with a start," he said, "I'll go off to sleep peacefully, and then with a start, I will wake up." That's right. Let me see. A couple more stories. Page 129. Master Song Hu, Meng Sifan, and Master Qin Zhang, three friends, said to one another, another story, "Who can join with others without joining with others? Who can do with others without doing with others? Who can climb up to heaven and wander in the mists, roam the infinite, and forget life forever and forever?" The three men looked at one another and smiled. There was no disagreement in their hearts, and so they became friends. This is the same line as the other story. They looking at each other, smiling, they know that they all know the same truths, or that they know they all see the world and life similarly, and that there's no disagreement in their hearts. That's why they smiled. When they looked at each other, they knew there was no disagreement in their hearts. That's why they smiled. Then, because of that, they became friends. And that's a good basis of friendship. No disagreement in their heart. You know, if it's not a good friend, it's not a friend. It's always strange to me how ordinary folks have all these trouble with their, quote, friends. If I have trouble with a person, I can't call them a friend. They're not a friend. We have trouble. With a real friend, there's no heavy trouble. Maybe little thing, but no big deal. In any case, the story goes on. After some time, again, which is what happens in human life, Master Sanghu died. He'd not yet been buried when Confucius, and so now we have the stock character of ignorant Confucius coming into Zhuangzi's story, hearing of his death, sent Zhigang, an assistant, to assist at the funeral, right, to do the proper Confucian funeral rites and ritual. When Zhigang arrived, he found one of the dead man's friends weaving frames for silkworms, while the other strummed a lute. Joining their voices, they together sang this song. Ah, Sanghu, ah, Sanghu, you've gone back to your true form, while we remain as men. Oh. Very much like nobody in Dead Man. Xebache sings things like this. Ah, Sanghu, ah, Sanghu, you have gone back to your true form while we remain as men. Oh. Not quite catchy, but... So you've gone back to your true form, we remain as men. Oh, alas. Then Confucius's representative, Zhigang, hastened forward and said, may I be so bold as to ask what sort of ceremony this is? Singing in the very presence of the corpse? How can you be happy where there's a corpse of your friend right in front of you? Or how can I be peaceful while there's a snake the other side of my room? Mm-hmm. The two men looked at each other and laughed. Ha ha, what does this man know of the meaning of ceremony? They said. Zhigang, the representative, then returned and reported to Confucius what had happened, and said, what sort of men are they, anyway? Lao Shi, he asked. They pay no attention to proper behavior, disregard their personal appearance, and without so much as changing the expression on their faces, they sing in the very presence of the corpse. I can think of no name for them. What sort of men are they? This is, super shameful from a Confucian perspective, and that was pretty much all across the culture. You know, the higher classes, the middle classes, everybody but the lowest, and in fact everybody at all economic levels would have been horrified at such a breach of what was considered proper etiquette, which was very Confucian, which is very reasonable, right? At the funeral, you grieve. Same thing here today, everywhere. And so they are seriously inappropriate in the presence of a corpse and in terms of conventional moral custom of funerary behavior. Confucius, however, gets the score and says, well, such men as they wander beyond the realm. Men like me, we wander within it. Beyond and within can never meet. It was stupid of me to send you to offer condolences. Even now they have joined with the Creator, even before death. Even now they've joined with the Creator as men to wander in the single breath of heaven and earth. Ah, single breath, same string. They look on life as a swelling tumor, a protruding one boil, and on death as the draining of a sore or the bursting of a boil. To men such as these, how could there be any question of putting life first or death last? They borrow the forms of different creatures and house them in the same body. They forget liver and gall, cast aside eyes and ears, turning and revolving, ending and beginning again, unaware of where they start or finish. Idly, they roam beyond the dust and dirt. They wander free and easy in the service of Wu Wei, the service of inaction. Why should they fret and fuss about the ceremonies of the vulgar world and make a display for the eyes and ears of the common herd? So this is, and Zhigang replies, well then, Master, what is this, quote, realm that you stick to? Confucius said, well, I'm one of those men punished by heaven. Nevertheless, I'll share with you what I have. And Confucius explains about the realm. But before that, it's top of 131, this reply that I went through here of Confucius to Zhigong. Very interesting. They wander in a single breath of heaven and earth. They wander beyond the realm of human conventional thinking, human conventional morality about right and wrong. They don't see right and wrong the same way ordinary folks do. It's the difference between ordinary and extraordinary, conventional, non-conventional, the customary and the exceptional. Beyond and within the realm can never meet. There is some sense, Jesus said, Yeshua said, I am from above, you're from below, period. It doesn't mean self, you know, Ra said, self is a being of infinite worth. So the worth of Yeshua and the worth of ordinary folks or non-saints is the same, infinite. Self is a being of infinite worth for all. You're all gods, we're all gods here, said Nityananda. So, okay, meanwhile, there are those who wander beyond and those who wander within the realm of conventional, dualistic, limited thinking. The human 3D consensus reality, consensus perspectives, consensus morality. Now, there's then crazy wisdom. And so you've got so-called crazy wisdom Buddhist teachers in the West who use that as a cover for sin or abusing students, or corruption, or bad behavior. Basically, some form of wrong speech, wrong action. So that's not the same. But these guys are not hurting anybody, right? They're not taking people in and saying, you do what I say because I'm outside conventional morality. If you come to them, they'll be themselves. If you leave them, they will not pursue you. You know, if he comes, don't reject him. If he leaves, don't pursue him. Like that. So they wander beyond the realm, and beyond the realm and within the realm can never meet. Yeshua was from above, and those he said he spoke to are from below. Wanderers are from above, 3D natives are from here, from the 3D plane. Meanwhile, self is a being of infinite worth, and true nature is one. Okay. But there's a big difference between conventional and enlightened. And I wouldn't presume I'm enlightened. I don't think anybody should. Meanwhile, these guys have something valuable to share, and we can know this. I mean, there's harmlessness with... one can be harmless and helpful while still wandering beyond the realm. Leap into the boundless and make it your home. Includes harmlessness, ahimsa, do no harm, and right speech and right action, for sure. But there are elements of action that are called wrong action to conventional perspective that would be considered folly from a more expanded awareness perspective, like loving life and hating death, or being miserable at death. I mean, you can be sad if you're sad, fine. But actually, the soul that died is still alive. Not in that body, but they're still alive, and they're on their way somewhere, or they're having experience, and it might be even more fulfilling than here. Anyway, they look on life as a tumor, as a boil, and death as the draining of a sore, bursting of a boil. One doesn't have to look at that either, but they've, even now, as men, they've joined with the Creator to wander in the single breath of heaven and earth, and the single breath of life and death. That's the point. His liking was one, and his not liking was one in a previous chapter or another chapter. His being one was one, and his not being one was one. Uh-huh. Other core teaching. And so it's sort of knowing, rightly acting in the realm of the in the world of men, in the realm of polarity, while still not forgetting who you are, where you're from, and where you're going, and the non-dual, as much as one can know it. They borrow the forms of different creatures and house them in the same body, and then they give them back. They roam beyond dust and dirt. They wander free and easy in the service of Wu Wei. They are workers for Wu Wei. And so, and then why should they fret and fuss about the ceremonies of the vulgar world and make a display for the eyes and ears of the common herd? And that's where we'll end for today. This is the middle page, 131, going 5 pages per hour. And next time, Confucius will explain to Zhigong what is the realm beyond the realm of the conventional, where these Zhenren roam. The Zhenren roaming beyond the realm of the conventional, where Confucian is still in the realm. This point, idly they roam beyond the dust and dirt, beyond attachment to the particulars, beyond attachment to preference. They wander free and easy in the service of Wu Wei. This is a beautiful line, I think. Anyway, that's it for today. And next time we'll pick up in the middle of 131, Zhigong asking about the realm, the worldly, and the perspective of the Tao, the Zhenren, who is wandering beyond the common. So I hope that was useful. It's very deep and interesting. This is really authentic 2,300-year-old or so Chinese philosophy. So I hope that was useful. Thanks again. Take good care of yourselves. See you next time, and good night.